Hello, welcome. Welcome to the 12th annual George Washington Prize celebration honoring Flora Fraser, the winner of the 2016 prize for her wonderful book, The Washingtons, George and Martha, Joined by Friendship, Crowned by Love. It's a pleasure to recognize our honored guests, members of the Board of Visitors and Governors, alumni, students, families, faculty, and friends, all gathered here this afternoon. The George Washington Prize was established in 2005 at Washington College's C.V. Starr Center for the Study of the American Experience, in partnership with George Washington's Mount Vernon and the Gilder Lehrman Institute of American History. That year, the prize was awarded to Ron Chernow for his biography, you might have heard of it, Alexander Hamilton, a book that in turn inspired a musical you may have already heard of, that you've probably heard about, which won a Washington Prize in its own right last year at a nice event we had in New York. At $50,000, the Washington Prize is one of the largest literary prizes in the nation, awarded annually for the year's best work about America's founding era. It particularly recognizes well-written books that contribute to a broad public understanding of American history and bring to light new or overlooked stories about our past. Flora Fraser's book is exemplary in both respects. While many historians have chronicled the first president's life and public service, no other writer has so thoroughly examined the marriage bonds between him and his wife as Flora Fraser does in The Washingtons. Researching George and Martha's relationship has certain challenges, since Martha, as you may know, burned all the letters between the two of them. But Fraser succeeds admirably in mining other sources to depict the very close relationship that was essential in establishing George's career and that also was a bedrock of support for him throughout the Revolution and beyond. The book was chosen from among dozens of nominees submitted to the Starr Center and evaluated by a panel of distinguished scholars in the field, with the final decision made by a committee of judges from each of the three co-sponsors. The prize was officially awarded to Flora Fraser last May at a gala dinner at Mount Vernon, and we are delighted that she's now traveled back across the pond from her home in London to join us for this celebration in Chestertown. I would like now to call on stage Adam Goodhart, the Hodson Trust Griswold Director of the Starr Center, who will introduce Flora Fraser. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Sheila, and thank you to all of you for coming to celebrate, including thank you to our dancers who filled the square with their music and movement. And to our student spontaneous dancers, some of whom I still see wearing their tricorn hats. Flora, we take the 18th century very seriously around here, in case you haven't noticed. And we have fun with it, too. I think we'll do both today. I'm delighted to introduce Flora Fraser, one of the most gifted biographers of our time. She has also been a delightful and generous guest since her arrival in Chestertown yesterday afternoon. She took traditional English tea in the Custom House with a group of our students, especially students interested in history and writing, yesterday afternoon. Today, she visited a freshman GRW class taught by Jean Wortman, the Starr Center's assistant director. And for our students to sit down and talk with Flora Fraser about crafting biographies is sort of like having a chance to take swim lessons from Katie Ledecky. It's really, really special. So thank you so much for that, Flora. And one of the interesting things that Flora Fraser told us over tea and cucumber sandwiches yesterday is that she got her start really at about the age of 14 doing research for her mother and grandmother. In effect, she was going into the family business because her mother, Antonia Fraser, and her grandmother, Elizabeth Longford, both were very acclaimed biographers. In the case of Antonia Fraser, she still is, of course. Like those maternal ancestors, Flora has written often about the lives of women. Her first book, a biography of Admiral Nelson's lover, Emma Lady Hamilton, came out when she was still in her 20s. Not to put any pressure on our student writers or anything like that, but pretty amazing. And since then, she's also written lives of Napoleon's sister, Pauline Bonaparte, Queen Caroline of Great Britain and the six daughters of King George III. Now, of course, she has written a book about King George's impudent little opponent, actually pretty big opponent, that other George, this one, of course, surnamed Washington. But the father of our country and the father of this college is only half the story, literally half the story, because the other half is the woman who, especially in light of Flora's book, might convincingly be called the mother of our country, Martha Washington. This dual biography, the Washingtons, George and Martha, joined by friendship, crowned by love, is a remarkable achievement, and all the more so because, as Sheila mentioned, almost all, actually, not quite all, but almost all of the letters between George and Martha were burned. Three of them survived, apparently because they were sort of stuffed into odd desk drawers at Mount Vernon. The three that survive are relatively boring letters, although you do make the most of what's there, but one hopes that there was spicier correspondence between them. She did burn them apparently in accordance with an agreement that they had made before George's death. But despite the formidable challenges, as the jurors for the Washington Prize wrote, this is a splendidly researched, vividly written reconstruction of the public and private lives of Martha and George and the connections to the Revolutionary era. In addition to her writing career, Flora Fraser co-founded the Elizabeth Longford Prize in Biography. She served as a trustee of the National Gallery in London, and she's been a patron of numerous other cultural and educational institutions. Flora will be speaking for about 15 or 20 minutes from the podium, and then I'll rejoin her here on stage for a conversation about her work. And afterwards, we'll all retire to the lobby, and you are very much invited as well to join the reception out there, and Flora Fraser will be signing some more copies of her book for those of you who needed her talk to convince you that you really wanted to buy it. But I suspect most of you are already fans. Also, I should add that this book will be available at half price to Washington College students. And now I am very pleased to welcome to stage the winner of the 2016 George Washington Prize, Flora Fraser.
Madam President, Adam, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here. And I would struggle to express in words the honor I feel to be the recipient of the George Washington Book Prize 2016. I get up and have done, we all get up, but I have got up to write all my life, my working life, and my passion for history and for communicating history has never dimmed. But I loved writing this book. And I'll tell you in a moment how it was that I came to write it. But this prize means a great deal to me. It has been awarded me by three institutions, George Washington College, Mount Vernon, and the Gilda Lehrman Institute for American History. Who institutions all paramount in their field, and in the field of the founding era, which I didn't know when I set out on my career of writing in the early 80s. I was always passionate about the 18th century. I love the way people wrote and thought then. It's, for me, the birth of the modern and an exciting time, the Enlightenment, a sort of, people talk now about the internet age as being, there's a flood of information out there. But in the 18th century, as I'm sure many of you many of you students here have come to know this, talking with your professors, there was equally a new flood of information. There was more education, there were better communications between countries. Someone in England would write, they would send for a book from Germany, and here, of course, in America, the colonial subjects of George II, George III would send to London for books published there. So it was always, for me, that time, the 18th century, was a time that appealed to me. But I didn't know when I began in the 1980s writing about Emma Hamilton, Nelson's mistress, that I would one day come to write about the inhabitants of Mount Vernon. And it's been a long journey from when I left university and started, as Adam mentioned, researching on Emma Hamilton. From that time when I turned from researching to actually writing the book, publishing it, and it's a journey on which I suppose this award, this George Washington Prize, has made me reflect a little on the journey that I have made with all the different characters that I have written about. So I'm immensely grateful to the college for the prize, and I'm not a little grateful that it's allowed me to look back with huge pleasure at a life of writing. I've still got many books to write, but the Washingtons, George and Martha, will always have a special place in my heart as a book where I think I really broke new ground. I crossed the Atlantic and I explored for the first time archives online. I sat at my desk in London every morning and communed with the papers of George Washington online, the University of Virginia and Mount Vernon have been steadily putting the papers of George Washington online, and I've been preaching to students here at the tea yesterday, in class today, the glories of that resource. This afternoon I had a quick look to see what came up with just putting in Chestertown to the search. And of course there's quite a bit, and not only because it's a natural, it's on the way between Mount Vernon and Philadelphia, but also because William Smith and Washington we're in correspondence, so anyone who wants to pursue further the amazing career of William Smith from Aberdeenshire via Philadelphia to Chestertown can find a little bit there. So your recognition has made me very proud, and it is very exciting for me to be here to meet new friends in the history faculty, and also to meet students who seem to me to have great futures, whether they choose those futures to be in the field of history or in other fields. I've rarely met a group of more engaged and engaging undergraduates. So thank you, all of you, for being with me at the tea yesterday and in the class with Jean today. But what made me, a Brit, decide to write about, gave me the notion that I, a Brit, could possibly write about America's premier first couple. And my long acquaintance with characters of the 18th century makes me open to anyone in that world. I feel that the founding fathers and mothers and English, their English counterparts, belong in a sense to the same world. And I've never felt that as strongly as when I visited 10 years ago Mount Vernon, and I approached Mount Vernon from the very English Bowling Green in front. I went into the mansion, as it's called, and I had a distinct impression, but this is so English. And then, of course, I was nearly knocked over by a great many American schoolchildren visiting the National Shrine. But as I went round the interior of Mount Vernon, I thought this impression remained with me. The rooms were very much of the size of the rooms in a manor house in an English village. And the furnishings seemed to me very English. In that, I was absolutely right, as I discovered on further investigation, because, of course, as colonial subjects and as a couple involved in the consignment trade with England of tobacco, the Washington sent tobacco from the plantation to England, and their London agents then sold the tobacco at what price they could get, and used that sum to buy all the furnishings, clothes, agricultural implements, everything the Washingtons and their neighbors all over Virginia did the same. It avoided any losses through currency exchange. And so Mount Vernon indeed was furnished in the English manner. And in a sense, because when the war broke out 15 years after the Washingtons had married, there was then 8 years when they were, Washington was away, Martha was with Washington in winter headquarters every, for all 8 winters of the war. There was a brief interregnum of 5 years before Washington is called to be first president. And then they're again away in first in New York, where Congress has its seat, then in Philadelphia. They're there for the next 8 years and only back for the final 2 years of Washington's life, which his retirement, to which he'd been looking forward so much, sadly cut off when he gets that painful and fatal throat infection and dies in December 99. So the house and all its furnishings and the way it's embellished with Martha's money in the 15 years after they marry. They marry in 59 and Martha is a wealthy widow, and they put that money towards embellishing Mount Vernon. It's a house effectively made in the English fashion with English furniture according to English rules, or if you like, fashion. There was never time. They simply never had the time to redecorate, should they have had the wish, in federal fashion. And so I think that gave me the idea, the strong idea, that the house was so English. But of course, then you come out onto this magnificent piazza. You would never have needed a piazza in any English manner, because there was no sun to need to shade you from, and nor would you ever have seen from the garden side of an English manor house the magnificent Potomac River, which you must imagine here, or the hills of Maryland beyond. And so I felt, and almost still I feel, that the journey of the Washingtons, the journey the Washingtons make from conservatism to radicalism, the way that in the 15 years of their marriage, which coincides more or less with the accession of George III to the throne, in those 15 years, 1760, as the punitive taxes come this way, as their resentment of the of what they see as the tobacco agents' various malpractices in London strengthens, they become more open to independence. And Washington is really one of the last to wish for action. There are many before him who wish for action. But when it comes, when he is elected commander-in-chief, he's absolutely resolute and is he and Martha become patriots through and through. And Washington is cool and measured and rational, and Martha is warm and instinctive, and they are an extraordinary pair. They fit like bacon and eggs, or because they are just as bacon and eggs are very different. Well, Washington is very, very tall, and Martha barely hits 5 foot. And of course, we all know the pictures of Martha as her hats, her mob caps get bigger and bigger as she gets wider and wider, and her chins grow more. But when they married, and for really through into the war, Martha's a very pretty and extremely elegant young woman, and remains elegant and dedicated to fashion throughout her life. She, when she is effectively the First Lady, Abigail Adams notes that Mrs. Washington's clothes were plain, but of the best. And this quality that they shared, a love of what was of the best. They had this perfectionism that they shared, and it didn't make them easy with everyone who formed part of their household, but it meant that Washington had the genius that is the infinite capacity for taking pains, and it was his infinite capacity for taking pains that kept the army together. How many letters he wrote to Congress from headquarters, always saying, I remain your humble servant, having told them exactly what was to happen. So they were an extraordinary couple to follow on this journey that they made together. And it is, as the president said, an oblique look at their marriage, my book, because only a few letters remain. But there are their letters to others, many, many letters. And above all, as they become more and more celebrated during the war, during the presidency, everyone writes about them, whether they're visiting headquarters, whether they're attending one of Martha's drawing rooms. There's a constant drip feed of information about them, how people see them. And what is plain is that Martha, without any wish to be a general herself or to be president of the United States, was somebody who could shore up Washington's nervous temperament, which I recognize from having earlier studied another 18th century personality, a hero, another hero, if you like, who had this same nervous sensibility. And Washington had this early chips on his shoulder, not given a position in the British Army, didn't have a proper education. And Martha was there, and she calmed him. She had this remarkable ability to calm him. During the war, the officers would let out a sigh of relief when she arrived at headquarters, because Washington's temper was could be immoderate. So it was this chance visit that I paid to Mount Vernon, and in 2006, it was another 4 years before I resolved that I did have the temerity to write, even though I was a Brit, about America's first couple. But I am so very happy that I did pay that visit, because it was a great pleasure and, of course, a tremendous education to write this book. And I grew to admire both Washington and Martha immensely, and I'm very happy to have had the chance to address you here in a college so closely associated with America's first president. Thank you.
Your book is so rich, not just with the answers that it gives, but with the questions that it raises for the reader and the way that it gets our minds working. I wanted to ask you, first of all, now, as you say, you'd written about the lives of women in the 18th and 19th centuries before, but those women were all in British or European continental courts. And so here you have Martha Washington, who's, well, they called it the court, some of their detractors called it the court of George and Martha. But I'm wondering what might be different about a powerful woman in the setting of an American democracy compared to powerful women in the center of politics in those European milieu?
Yes, it's a good question. And when George assumes the presidency, there could have been no role at all for Martha. There's nothing about it in the Constitution. Washington is very careful when he's discussing with, right at the beginning, just days after he's taken, after he's been inaugurated as president, he discusses with Adams, with Hamilton, exactly how much he can go out and about. And the answer is the president can have no private life. So of course Washington is a Virginian. I mean, he and Martha entertain constantly at Mount Vernon. They're sociable, they're hospitable. And even though Washington might sit back and say little at these gatherings, he's used to the va-et-vient. And so he does write back and say, could the president appear rarely at tea parties? To which the answer is absolutely not. So they know that they are in a rather gilded cage, if you like. And the question is, because they are absolutely making it up as they go along. And Washington makes up this levee, this assembly where he, gentlemen will come to the townhouse, which has become the president's house on Cherry Street in New York, and he will receive them. And he only makes that receiving hour on a Tuesday because he's finding that people are dropping in the whole time and he can't get anything done. Mm-hmm. So he's got to do something to, so you have that. And there's also a Thursday dinner, the Congress dinner, where he and Martha's there because they are a couple and they have members of Congress and the Senate with their wives and European ministers, ambassadors. But on Fridays, every Friday, Martha receives, she has her own drawing room. And we were talking about this in class today. And that is, there was no need, in a sense, for her to receive. But she's following the example of Queen Charlotte in London. And the king has his levee and the queen has her drawing room. So both of these, the levee and the drawing room in New York and later in Philadelphia, are open to criticism as being monarchical, particularly from those like Jefferson, who knew personally the courts of Europe. Adams, who knew, of course, the courts of France and of the court of St. James, admired the court of St. James, so was thought it was absolutely fine. But that giving Martha this very public role where she is the hostess, although these may seem trivial matters, at the time, form and ceremony mattered a great deal. Like, I suppose, people interpret whether the Chinese leaders today on National Day are holding their own umbrellas. I mean, that might mean this or it might mean that. And the fact that Martha was the hostess and that Washington was a guest and so did not wear a dress sword because he was a guest, or, you know, these things mattered, and so she was a public person, as I say. They were public people who could not be private.
Well, you mentioned that the Constitution doesn't say anything about the First Lady, and of course that name, that title wasn't invented until much later, but famously the Constitution doesn't say much about the President either.
Yeah.
And so, except you've got this chief executive officer who's elected every 4 years. So could it be said that she was sort of working together with George to invent the presidency as well during those years?
Yes, I think the two of them, I think the two of them are, it's for them a duty, it's part of the nation building. They're looking beyond their own time during the two terms that Washington serves to what will follow after, to the president's
and how the office of president and how the interaction, which is so important, of the president with the rest of, with the public, will work. And they are consummate hosts and hostesses. I mean, whether Martha's on a camp stool eating off tin plates in a log cabin at headquarters, she's still, you know, receiving their very important French emissaries before the alliance is sealed. She's just as consummate a hostess there, making sure everything's going smoothly as she is at Mount Vernon privately. And she puts in, you know, she puts in a lot to this, to this, this role. We know from their private correspondence that neither of them greatly relish it, but they are determined to do it as well as they possibly can, because they see it as so important.
Maybe you could tell us more. You mentioned Martha sort of eating off of tin plates and log cabins, and you know, when we picture her, we tend to think of this sort of dignified lady in her fine clothes presiding over dinner party at Mount Vernon or in the presidential mansion. But could you tell us about that moment in Martha's, well, more than a moment in Martha's life, when she was practically on the battlefield?
Yes. When Washington goes to Cambridge Common in July 75 to take command of this fairly raggle-taggle army, he's worried that Martha will miss him. And she'll be lonely at Mount Vernon, and he suggests her having relations to stay, going to stay with relations. And what he doesn't anticipate is that he misses Martha, and it's he who calls for Martha in November of that year, while the American armies besieging Boston, and she goes to join him. This first headquarters is the very fine Vassal House in Tory Row in Cambridge, recently vacated by the Vassal family. So that's one of their better winter headquarters. And now famous as the Longfellow House, but when they move to New York, Martha goes too, and so she's there, and she only retires really from Washington's side when the summer campaigning season starts. And it, you know, it will be a question of days. And then as soon as they've reached headquarters, and we're talking Valley Forge, when the army is probably at its worst off, no money, no firewood, no provisions. Morristown in New Jersey, the hardest winter of the war, when officers and men are buried in their tents like sheep under snow. She's there, and her journeys are not pleasant, because the summer return to Mount Vernon is generally okay, but when she is traveling from Mount Vernon to the headquarters, it's through, you know, the snow, these terrible roads, and she never complains. And it's something that I had no idea, that she was there with him. And then you start reading the correspondence of those at headquarters. And there's a rather fun detail, and I don't know if any of you have been lucky enough to see Hamilton, but when she names the tomcat at headquarters Hamilton, because he's always out roving. But she's...
That's true.
Yeah, yeah. And she's very much there promoting the match between Hamilton and Betsy, who's the niece of a local doctor when they're in one headquarters. And so you get this sort of Martha being a very much, George and Martha being a team at both at in the war and being a team during the presidential years. And there is no one who is angrier with Jefferson about his attacks, the anti-federalists' attacks on Washington, than Martha. And she famously, I think, says when she's a widow and many from Washington, which has just become the seat of government, come to Mount Vernon to pay her visits of condolence in the years once Congress is established there. And she is quite outspoken all her life, and a visitor is rather startled when she says, when he's paying her a visit of condolence, apart from the day when the president died, the worst day of my life, says Martha, was when Mr. Jefferson came to pay me a visit of condolence. So she was a passionate woman. She passionately loved Washington. She passionately loved her children. She passionately loved Mount Vernon. But she was a fierce hater too.
Well, speaking of passion and speaking of their private lives, I don't want to get too salacious here.
No.
But you have written before about couples for whom, obviously, like Emma Hamilton and Lord Nelson, there are very strong erotic elements to their lives. Can you speculate at least on the Washington sex life together? Do you have a sense of, was there physicality to their relationship along with the sort of collaboration and mutual respect?
Yeah, without getting salacious, I will now speculate. And I think, first of all, I think that she was a very pretty young widow, and he was an extremely handsome man, and you can, I think, the best portrait of Washington is the life-size, or maybe possibly a little more than life-size, Udon portrait statue of him. He's standing, and it's in the Capitol in Richmond, and you see this fine figure of a man, and Martha always said that no portrait did him justice, which is the sort of thing that someone says when they're absolutely mad about someone. But I rather love that, given all the portraits that were done, that not one satisfied her. there was only late in life did Washington show a kind of interest in another woman? And I would say it was a passionate friendship, if it even got that far. Mrs. Powell, the wife and then the widow of the mayor of Philadelphia, and she's a very interesting character, and she was passionate about politics. She was a great admirer of Washington. I think he liked this attention that he got from Mrs. Powell. I don't think that anything more happened, but Washington had before Martha been kind of tentative in his attempts to find a bride. There was one, didn't come to anything. He liked married women, I think for good reason, that they were married, you know. And, but I think, you know, it was in one sense a marriage of convenience, Martha and George. She secures a guardian for her two small children, for their fortunes, and someone to manage her own. He secures the wealth of this widow, which is his to have for his life. And then it returns to her, and in due course, because it's a dowry money, it will return to the Park Custis estate and go to her children. But my feeling, and I say this in the book, is that Martha was, from the beginning, smitten by Washington. Mm. I mean, who wouldn't be? He was a soldier in uniform. He was handsome. He had the best seat on a horse of anyone in Virginia. He danced till 3 a.m. on any given night. And I think he just took longer to not, I don't think their sex life, I think it's very difficult to speculate about people's sex lives. I'm assuming it was a good and sex life satisfied them both. I can't speculate more than that, but the passion between them, the attachment between them really gets markedly stronger, I think, during the war, when he just begins to value her. Mm. And Nathaniel Green, I think it is, General Green writes to his wife that the couple, that the Washingtons, who've by then they've been married for 20 years, they are excessive fond. And that means pretty tactile. And that's what you'd say of a couple in those days who were just married. So they don't have children. Martha's given birth to 4 children, 2 of whom died young. Who knows? And again, people have had many theories why Washington didn't have a child. You know, there's no reason that we know of. But this, I think, we can be sure of, that Martha was the one who had failed, because in those days, the woman was the one who had who was thought to have a fertility problem. And if you take the example of Napoleon's wife, Josephine, she went endlessly to spas, which was where women went because drinking the waters was meant to promote fertility. And she'd had two children, Josephine, and yet she was the one who went to the spa, not Napoleon. Anyway, luckily Napoleon, by another wife, did have a child, so all was good, if not for Josephine. but in the case of the Washingtons, there is one summer when they go with another couple, the Fairfaxes, who are also childless, and they go to a spa in Berkeley Springs. And, you know, if they went to the spa for fertility reasons, it would have been because the women could drink the waters and promote. And Washington believed that he could have children always, because he writes, "If Mrs. Washington were to die, I would not wish to, I think it is, to have a child." So he had no doubt that he had a child.
That it wasn't his problem.
That it wasn't his problem. Yeah. And that's just how things were then. But I'm sure that it was a sadness between them.
Yeah. And we know it wasn't for want of trying that they
and
didn't,
we know yeah, exactly. No, so, I mean.
But, you know, speaking of their children, they, of course, there were her two children and then grandchildren who were problematic. They weren't exactly the Bobbsey twins. They weren't these sort of perfect little rosy-cheeked cherubs. Well, especially her son. And then, of course, poor Patsy, who died. But was that a difficulty, and was that a sort of an important force in their relationship, that they had these children? And how was George's relationship to them? Was he fully paternal, and was it tough for him when they didn't?
They both, I mean, he was like a father, because the Jackie and Patsy, Martha's Park Custis children, their father had died before they, I mean, they couldn't, I don't imagine they could remember, certainly Patsy couldn't. So they came to Mount Vernon, they were under five, and they were effectively children of Mount Vernon, and Washington was like a father to them, a very fine guardian of their wealth. And Washington longed to give Jackie the education that he himself hadn't had. He didn't want Jackie to turn out the Virginian horse racer, as he put it, by which I don't mean he was going to turn into a thoroughbred, but that he was going to own racehorses, bet on them. And of course, all of this, effectively, that was just what Jackie did.
He was sort of a dumb frat boy, right?
And
not to suggest that fraternity members are dumb, I should say, at Washington College, our fraternity members are extremely academic high achievers. But he was one of those kinds of frat boys, is what I mean.
Yeah, he was a kind of the sort of just all that Washington feared he would become. A drinker, a lazy, bad at managing his money, all of this. But Washington hadn't thought that while he was still at school, he'd get secretly engaged to a 15-year-old girl. So that had to be sorted out. And Washington arranged still for Jackie to go off to university, to King's College, now Columbia, hoping that the engagement could last, you know, and then in due course they would marry. But this was where this was one of two areas, I would say, where Washington and Martha weren't in accord. Martha spoiled her son and her grandson and wanted to actually have them at home, was kind of thrilled, frankly, with the idea of him getting married and then she'd have some grandchildren. Well, it came to pass all too quickly because he dropped out and within a few years had a family of four.
And his son wasn't a whole lot better.
Was not a whole lot better. In fact, he followed exactly the same pattern. Later on, he is the master of Arlington. He sort of became rather sweet and a sweet older man, padding round, showing people the Mount Vernon relics that he had bought at the sale after Martha's death, and writing some fairly highly colored reminiscences of life with them. But at the time, Washington was just tearing his hair out all over again, because Wash, as he was called, George Washington Parke Custis, the grandson, Wash was there with his sister Nellie, who was a paragon, of course. These were the first children in the presidential mansion, the grandchildren. They were with the Washingtons in New York in the Cherry Street house, later in the house on Broadway, and then in the Morris house in Philadelphia. And Nellie was, you know, marvelous performer on the pianoforte, beautiful watercolors, nice group of friends. And Wash, you know,
not so much.
No, and Washington sort of and Martha disagreed, because she just spoilt them, and it was this this side of Martha, her weakness for these Custis heirs, these Custis ne'er-do-wells, which was hard for Washington, who could see that simply they were ne'er-do-wells, and he had given them, you know, all the opportunities for education, for they had all the opportunities that wealth could offer that he himself had not had.
I should mention there's a Chestertown and Washington College connection there, because Washington and Jackie Custis came through Chestertown basically on their college visiting trip in 1772, and that was when they had dinner in the place where you will soon have dinner, the Hinson Ringgold House, which is now the residence of President Bear. So all roads lead to Chestertown, always, as you know.
Yeah. They do.
But I should probably make this the last question.
Okay.
John Adams, who, as we know, could be a very snarky fellow, was snarky about the Washingtons after their death, probably before their deaths as well. But he wrote a letter in which, as you know, and you quote in the book, he more or less said that without Martha, George Washington would have been a big fat nobody. And do you think that's fair?
Well, I think that he says, yes, without the wealthy Mrs. Custis.
And without his good looks, he also says, doesn't he?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Without Washington's.
And I think it is, looking back to the young Washington, and of course he was young, you can, it's okay to make mistakes, but he was a fairly awkward young man, And with Martha, I think he blossomed. And I think she gave him confidence. Mm. And yes, his wealth, her wealth, brought him the much-needed opportunities to improve Mount Vernon, an estate they didn't even own at the time that they married, which he subsequently inherited. He was tenanting it. I think it was the confidence that she gave him, this shoring up of his nervous, heroic temperament, which helped him to withstand those years of war, when sometimes he was lying awake at night, as he says, not knowing, you know, where the next batch of gunpowder would come from, whether how they were going to get enough men to in, given that you know, the term was coming to the end of one set of troops, and he faced such extraordinary odds, and he chose very well in his staff. Green, Knox were exceptional men. There were very fine individuals at Congress, but it wasn't an easy machine to deal with. And I think that just having Martha there, and certainly during the presidency, when the second term really was extremely difficult, he was very much under attack, and there's somebody says the turpitude of the Jacobins hurts him very badly, and so he felt things, he felt attacks terribly, and I think Martha was tough, she was redoubtable, and she didn't she helped him keep going.
So just as she as he chose well in those aides like Hamilton and Knox, I think he chose very well in his wife too, and she picked the right horse as well, didn't she?
She did. She picked the right horse.
And I think we picked the right horse with your book. Congratulations to
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Flora. It's great having you here, and an honor.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bumping microphones.
Yeah.
Thanks to all of you.